Last year, a friend of mine and his wife sold their home, bought an RV, installed solar panels and a battery system, and then hit the road with an absurd number of pets, all while working as a software developer from the road. Now, I couldn't help myself. Between the solar panels, the batteries, and the crazy layered internet connection that he's using, I just had to talk to him to find out what it's been like, and if he's been able to successfully live the energy-independent life while on the move, and without losing his mind. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. There are definitely pros and cons with the tiny house, van, and RV lifestyle that's been growing in popularity over the past couple of decades. Less things in your life can be freeing, but pulling it off successfully can be challenging, let alone with the added expense and complexity of adding solar, energy storage, and trying to ensure a good network connection. My friend Steve Haynes decided to take the plunge right before the pandemic hit. He'd already been working mostly remote for his job, so it raised a bunch of questions.
Even before the pandemic hit, we kind of decided that, like, why do we need to be stationary? Like, let's go check out some stuff. And my wife was originally wanting to go backpack Europe, but we have a lot of animals. We have a couple dogs, a couple cats, and a couple bunnies. So living in an RV and kind of going around felt like a good backup plan for, like, exploring the United States and checking out all the landmarks and national parks and stuff.
The first step they had to figure out was finding the right kind of RV for their situation. Being a developer, he was going to need a really good work setup.
We looked at bunkhouse models and all these different ones and, like, how we could, like, refit the spaces. And we kind of landed on this model is it's a toy hauler. So the toy hauler means, like, it has a garage in the back. That's where I'm at right now. So the garage kind of worked out as a great space to set up for an office, but we could also, you know, store our mountain bikes and other equipment, and the dogs could hang out with me all day.
When it came to figuring out what they were going to need for solar is where it gets a little tricky and interesting. Steve isn't an electrician and doesn't have a lot of experience with solar, so he ended up working with a company that specializes in doing exactly this kind of conversion, Northern Arizona Wind and Sun.
So they sell kits, but if you get a hold of them, they will also do custom designs, and the design consultation process is all kind of free of charge, included in the bid for a kit. So they kind of work through, like, your specifics of your model of RV, you know, how many panels you can fit on the roof, and what your specific needs are for the rest of the component. I basically went and picked it up, and they had a lot of the components already installed on a sheet of plywood that we pre-measured to make sure it would fit in my truck as well as in the install location. And I was just responsible for doing the rest of it.
After getting the component board and remaining parts, Steve and his dad, Frank, were able to complete the installation. Now, when getting solar installed in your home, you typically look at your electric bills over the course of a year to figure out what your energy needs are and to properly size the solar panel system on your home. In Steve's case, he couldn't do this since they hadn't lived in their RV to understand their exact energy needs. The best you can do in that situation is some back-of-the-napkin math on devices that you're planning on running, making educated guesses for how much they'll pull over time. And for Steve, he kind of went, how can I put this? A little nuts with sizing his system.
It was pretty much just like fit as many as you can on there. So I went on the roof and I kind of measured out different rectangles and kind of, all right, how can I fit like two panels here or three there with having like an even number of panels? Because for the system design, we ended up using two solar charge controllers. So having an even number of panels just simplified the wiring for that.
He ended up installing 8 REC Alpha Series 360 watt panels on the roof of the RV. Now, these are just standard panels like you'd install in your home. And they're running a bunch of Victron components for the charge controllers and 24 volt inverters. Overall, he installed 2.8 kilowatts of solar on the roof of the RV. Knowing that dictated how much battery storage he'd need to ensure smooth operation, but that also came down to a pretty simple choice.
So it's really just how much batteries could we fit and afford at the same time, because we wanted to go lithium. So we ended up going with 3 Simplify batteries that are the 3.8 kilowatt hour batteries. And so if you kind of boil it down to a 12 volt system, which most of the RV runs on, I think we're at around 900 amp hours if you're comparing it to other systems out there. But the batteries themselves are also designed for houses. They're not really like specific for RVs.
So over the time you've been using them now, what are you finding for like your energy needs? Is it satisfying your energy needs, or are you having to plug in?
Yeah. So it kind of depends on, like, for me, a lot of it has to do with how late I stay up. So I, you know, stay up and mess around on the computer a lot. So like the evening usage is higher than I think most, but daily I'm only using, at least from the tools that I'm using to measure it, about 30% of the capacity. So that's like really in the morning, I'll wake up and within 3 hours that 30% is already like restored battery bank. So it's a bit overkill. But on the plus side of that is if we have cloudy days, I'm getting anywhere between, you know, 2 to 3 days without even, you know, emptying the battery bank easily. And it still pulls in a little bit of energy on the cloudy days. So
when it comes to the biggest energy sinks in his setup, it really just comes down to the furnace and his desktop computer that he uses for work and for gaming.
But the desktop computer is really only pulling like around 200 watts most of the time. So, in the daytime, I'm not even like scratching the surface of what's coming in, to be honest.
Aside from a few cold days that threw some random warnings on the system, they functioned just fine. The 6 months he's been on the road with the system have been working out pretty well.
It's funny because like we pull in the RV parks that actually were paying for electricity hookup, and I don't even plug it in. I don't need it. So it's like, it's kind of cool to do that. We'll hook up to the water, but then, yeah, like the one I'm at right now, like we didn't plug it in at all. So it's pretty cool.
Viewing and managing the system is all through a Victron Energy dashboard. There's a dashboard that's installed inside the RV that they can check out at any time, but there's also a web portal they have access to for a deeper dive in the data.
What we're looking at here is the Victron dashboard from the web portal. So from the kind of brain component that I hooked up, this gives you kind of the high level view that pretty much shows like identical to what I see on the touchscreen, where it shows like right now, like, you know, we're at 100% charge, but it shows you, you know, like what's coming in from solar, what you're using AC, what you're using DC. And then on the charging part, it's kind of the net of that. Total minus the two. If I had the generator on, or if I was plugged into shore power, it would show that what's coming in from AC. Say I was actually plugged in and it's nighttime, and like the shore power went out, it switches so fast that like my computer wouldn't even register it as a power outage.
As for the shift from living in a house to living on the road, that's been easier for him than it would have been for me.
I've always enjoyed camping and being on the outdoors, so it wasn't too big of a shift for me. You know, of course there's a smaller space, so it was just kind of getting used to that. We try to switch spots every couple weeks, so we're getting like, we're kind of just working our way around the country right now and checking things out.
I love the change in scenery too, but like I said, adjusting to such a small space would be really tough, and I'd really miss my fiber optic gigabit connection that I need to upload massive files to YouTube. But Steve has a solution for that too, and it really surprised me how well it's working out. And no, it's not Starlink, even though we did talk about that.
So primarily we're off of cell phone technology. And what I've found is the main thing is like having multiple layers of backups, because like every location to go to is different. I have two different AT&T SIMs. We have our cell phones on Verizon. And we have an iPad also hooked up to Verizon Unlimited. We're using a Pepwave modem, which is LTE modem, and it has the ability to like disconnect and swap antennas. So if we're in a situation where, say, we have a really weak signal, I have a 2x2 MIMO Yagi antenna set up, which is a big directional antenna that I hoist up a mast on the side of the RV, and then I can point it at the best signal that I can find, basically. Now what I'm on is my Verizon cell phone tethered into the computer, and it's got, I think 5G right now. So I think I did a speed test when we got here, it was at 100 megabits per second.
But what about Starlink? Well, right now Starlink is only for stationary homes, so he's not able to take advantage of it quite yet, but that's not stopping him from trying.
I have done the pre-order for sure on that. The early indications, they're saying that they're going to lock you to a location, but I figured get in line anyway. We'll see what happens, you know, when they actually roll it out.
Just as I was putting this video together, news broke that SpaceX is seeking regulatory approval to go mobile. They've applied for a blanket license authorizing operation for Earth stations in motion. Elon clarified this in a tweet stating that this is for aircraft, ships, large trucks, and RVs. So it looks like Steve may be getting Starlink up and running at some point soon. If and when he does, I'm really interested to hear how well it works out. And finally, being energy independent has its pluses.
We were coming to this location and, you know, because we're in Texas, they just had the winter storms and, you know, power outages and all that. And the only thing we really had to worry about was like, can we drink the water? And can we buy food at the grocery store? Otherwise, like, you know, power and everything, we were covered. But yeah, it was just changes the conversation around that. We were even like, we have relatives here, and it was like, you want us to come by? Because like, we're pretty much bringing up, we have a portable generator. And we can just like hook up to your house potentially and, you know, get you back online for a bit. But
that's pretty cool. That's cool. You're ready for the zombie apocalypse. That's what this is.
Yes, exactly. That's actually what everything has been spec'd for the apocalypse, for sure.
If you're thinking of doing something like this, don't forget that. It's an important factor. But seriously, in the end, Steve has a great setup for traveling the country, changing his view from his front door whenever he wants, all while being able to do his job effectively. Now, I don't know if I could do what he's doing, but there's a part of me that's really jealous. What about you? Have you thought about doing something like this? Interested in hearing more about his experience with Starlink if and when he gets it up and running? Jump in the comments and let me know. If you'd like more details on the parts that he used for his setup, check out the website article I've linked in the description. I've included all the details there. And if you haven't checked it out yet, I do a follow-up podcast with my brother each week where we talk more about each of the weekly videos from the channel. And we also stray off a little bit and talk about things we've been watching, reading, or even playing. It's part of the reason why it's called Still to Be Determined. So be sure to check out the YouTube version of the show or subscribe to the audio podcast at stilltbd.fm. It kind of fits with the whole Undecided theme. Links are also in the description. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I have linked to right here. Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. And as always, thanks to all my patrons and to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.